consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior, sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you, everyone.
It's so much fun for me to have the Spainhowers leading out on my week. I really like that. They didn't even hear me, so they don't know. Let's have a word of prayer. Gracious God, thank you for Sabbath. What a gift. Thank you for friends who gather here and people we don't know yet, but we want to get to know. Thank you for your wonderful family that's gathered all across the earth today to worship. Please bless each one and bless us here too, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. That's really hot, you guys. Anyway, we have a new sound system, I understand. So be prepared for anything, but it's probably going to be wonderful. Okay? So I guess the first thing I need, Carter, are announcements. Can we go there? Okay, Tracy Hammond, this is thank you to you because he saw a need and he's taking the lead to fill it. Are you going to ask for help? Come on up.
Dan is here, by the way. Yes. Hello, happy Sabbath, everyone. I have my own slide. Hallelujah. It's
before anymore, it's his birthday today.
Yes. Today is my birthday. Happy Sabbath. I'm a 1969 model, whatever that equals out to. I like to say it that way. It sounds better. I had a wonderful experience happen the other day when I was up on my roof putting a roof together. I thought, boy, it sure is nice to have a roof on a house and know how bad the damage is and get it done. And then God said, there's someone else that needs a roof. Let's do that one too while you're on a roll. And there's a couple here at our church that I love very much. One is always out at the prison, always there, rain or shine. He's always, he's awesome. And one has a great philosopher, a great woman that loves, what does she love? Birds, exactly. She loves eagles and birds and owls and all this, and she's really good at PowerPoint, and she's really good at talking about God. This couple need a roof real bad, and I've decided no matter what the cost, we're going to get the roof on that house, and it's God's idea, and so Nancy's been encouraging me, Pastor Bolin's been encouraging me, let's just go out there and let's fix their house up. Let's do it. I spend so much money on things that aren't food. It must be because I'm blessed by God. And so I'm going to put a little treasure where in heaven, where it belongs. And I've decided, and I found out through Pastor Jim that there's a fund here at the church. If we donate to the emergency fund, which needs some funding to do this project, then it's actually a tax deduction, and it helps to these people that are in need, and it's a blessing. So if anyone really needs a mission and they want to help out Dan and Vivian, they can write on their tithe envelope emergency fund and give to this cause. It's a worthwhile cause. We're going to be stripping off. I already started stripping off the shingles. There's, you know, 3 or 4 layers of shingles to rip off. And then it's fun. It's going to be a fun project. And anyone want to come out and help, please come over. I'll be there tomorrow, Sunday and Monday. I have off, and then after work the rest of the week, get a hold of me.
Well, working is good.
Yes.
Because it helps you afford the things.
Exactly.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Tracy. What a blessing you are.
8 o'clock in the morning.
8 o'clock in the morning. If you need to know the address, there are several people here who might know it. It's Atlantic, right? Okay. 2411 Atlantic in Boise. South Atlantic. Okay, and on top of everything else, tomorrow, there's going to be a wedding here at 5 p.m., and you are invited to bring sides for the potluck if you wish, but you can come anyhow. If you don't want to bring food or can't bring food or whatever, come and enjoy the wedding and stay for the potluck if you wish. I have it on good authority that it's going to be lasagna and sides. Okay, next one, Carter. Okay, Bob and Paula could use some help tomorrow too with yard work. And okay. Oh, so they don't need help right now. We can help you later. Getting a house ready to sell is just ugly. I'm sorry. We did it last summer. I hated it. Okay. Pastor Jim Snowcomb.
I get to tell something fun. If you've noticed, there's some more cars out in our parking lot and in the neighborhood than normally are here in CUNA. It's CUNA Days weekend. And, you know, we've done things, I guess, in the past for CUNA Days, ways to show our community that we are here for you as well. We don't participate in a lot of the things that are going on in the sense of, you know, selling items and things like they do in the park. But what we're going to do here from 4 to 7 today, if you come out here, if you want to be here a part of this, we're going to serve snow cones right out front to anybody that's passing by, a free snow cone, cool them off. You know, I was telling Tracy this morning that Jesus said, when you give a cup of cold water to someone in my name, that's a good thing. Well, we're just adding flavor to it.
Yeah, why not?
Right?
And cold.
Yeah. So if you want to help with that, I know Rick Johnson and I will be here. And there's also some other areas that people, if we have more than enough CUNA Days, contacted me. They said they could use some help doing some service work down at the park, helping with crosswalk and things. So you know what? These are things that we do. It's good to serve our fellow men. And this is a good day to do it. So if you want to help with that, come here 4 o'clock today. Thanks.
We want our church to be known for more than just extra parking for ball games, etc. And believe me, when there are games at the school, there are lots of people parking here. But that's okay, too. We like that. All right, I think we can transition. Oh, there is a Idaho Conference Women's Retreat, and there's info on the bulletin board, and you can get a deal if you sign up on or before the 15th. Molly. Okay. All right. And they should start, if it's dusk, it should be around 9:30. Okay. Okay. Because I'm noticing how much the time is moving from the horrible time it was setting during the middle of the summer. Yeah, I'm not happy about that. But I'm closing my mom's blinds in her room about 15 minutes sooner than I was in the middle of June. So that tells me what's happening. Okay, we're going to start with praises and prayer requests. Who's writing them? Oh, good. All right, I want to tell you a couple things. I found out that I'm extremely allergic to the antibiotic clindamycin. And you know what happens? I get so dizzy that I almost can't walk from my bed to the bathroom. And I also, they call it ralphing some places. Yeah, I lost the non-contents in my stomach about three times during the day on Thursday. So we aren't taking that anymore. And I'm just happy I'm not dizzy anymore, because, you know, weird things happen with medicine sometimes, and I'm just glad mostly it works. And then the other thing that's really big in my life is tomorrow my husband and I are celebrating 39 years of marriage. Yeah. And today is Tracy's birthday, and I understand, Steve, it was yours yesterday. So happy birthday to all. Yeah, all right. Praises and prayer requests. Any praises? I praise God that I didn't get sicker. Here we go.
Amen. Thank you. Happy Sabbath, everybody. My wife and I are going for, she has a test coming up on Thursday. It's like a walking test or something, or a breathing test or something. And I'm going for my CAT scan on Tuesday, 8:30 in the morning.
Okay.
Not worried. Praise the Lord. That's great. And please keep us in prayer. We're in the process right now of getting our townhouse, hopefully that we will receive that, if it's God's will.
Yeah, exactly. I'm so glad you aren't worrying about it anymore, Bob. I think that's just incredible, because you know what worry is. It's the funny feeling that God left us in charge. Thankfully, he didn't. Okay, yes, Jim.
Well, would like prayer for Cowboy Camp meeting next week.
Yes.
And we apologize. We're not going to be here, and half the church is going to be gone. Sorry, preacher.
I think he'll be brave. All right. Winter, summer's always kind of, ugh. Oh, Norlin, go ahead.
Our anniversary will be on August 21st.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm trying to talk Mark into going into totality and get our picture taken as the eclipse comes over, but he won't do that. So.
Oh, yeah. Hello.
Yeah. Once in a lifetime. And so.
Well, once in several lifetimes, I would think.
Exactly. Probably. We'll never come over directly over us ever again while we're still here. But anyway, that's 53 years. So
that's really neat. A neat way to mark that one for sure. Okay, Desiree.
Praise that my dad is very slowly getting better.
Amen.
So that's a praise. And also, I have a praise this week also. I was really sick one day, and I'm just glad that it was only a 24-hour flu that I had.
Yeah.
And so I'm just thankful that that's all it was. And I also, Marilyn sent me a text that she couldn't come to church because of her plantar fasciitis.
Oh, her foot.
Is that what you call it? Yeah.
Yeah, so plantar fasciitis, I think.
Thank you. Prayers for Marilyn for that.
Yeah, that hurts.
It just stops you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and always unspoken.
Yeah. And Norlin is not done. Go ahead.
Sorry. We have a visitor, and I wanted to introduce him. He's right over there sitting by himself. Ken Reitz, not Reitz. It's spelt a little different.
Ken,
and he's from Oregon.
Welcome, Ken. We're glad to have you
here. He moved to CUNA over at Crimson Point.
Well, so what a good idea that was. Yes. All right. okay.
Candy. I thank the Lord for a safe trip to North Dakota, but pray for a rain in North Dakota because it's very dry.
Mm. Yeah. Well, I'm always glad to see Ketty here. It's wonderful to see Ketty. Anything else? Oh, yes, love. We'll get there. Go ahead, love.
We praise and thank God for all the prayers. We have a safety trip in Arizona, and we just want to let you know that God allowed us to stay here one more year. Arizona is not for us, so we're so thankful.
I don't know anybody who would want to be there this time of year. Go ahead,
Just to continue on a common theme here, August 2nd, 1981, this lady and I got married. And so we're celebrating 36 years this year.
You'll catch up eventually.
Maybe. I don't know. We'll see. That's our plan anyway. I'd like also to enlist your prayers, please, for my mom as she continues her struggle with, with cancer.
It's what kind does it remind me?
She had an abdominal cancer.
Oh, okay.
And it's kind of, she had it removed, and now it's kind of spreading, and so chemotherapy is the next, the next...
big deal.
Big deal, yeah. So she's going through that right now.
Betty Blue, that is, for anybody who doesn't know. Yes, Dan. Oh, I've got somebody where? Oh, now I know what's going on.
I just want to... say thanks to the church for, and to God for supplying Tracy to deal with, help me deal with my issues. As all of you know, I have plenty of my own, but as always, I want to remember the guys and gals out at the prison. I had a full class last week, and we need to praise God for that, because every person I get to connect with, even if they don't become an Adventist, they're in God's people, and that's really, really important for those kind of people.
Yes, absolutely.
And
God's leading them. We don't have to worry about that part.
Yep. I praise God. I've been doing it for 17 years, and I have no idea how many seeds have germinated beyond planting them, and I just praise God that He gave me the ability to do it.
Yeah, and you know what? Your reunion up in heaven might be astounding. Wouldn't that be? It's going to be fun to see it.
It will be an interesting experience. I can definitely tell you that.
Yep. Because they'll be free at last.
I want to remember my wife and her job. It is extremely stressful right now. They're trying to give her a laptop, and they can't get the software to work, and they've spent 2 weeks on it, and they still can't solve the issues.
Ooh.
It's between two different companies and lots of different softwares. So end result is chaos.
Yes. It's called the bleeding edge of technology.
And she's struggling with it big time because it's adding stress to the job she's already trying to do. So just remember my wife and her job, because I really want her to, she almost left her job last week.
Yeah.
And that would throw my house into chaos that I don't want to deal with. So as much as I don't want her to be in the hell she's in, at the same time, I want her to be happy with what she does. So
absolutely.
I need God's help in this one.
Yeah. Anything else? Yes, John? No, you need a mic.
We asked for prayer for Renee this week. She's facing a major medical thing Monday. The T word could be it. And I have a pit bull that I really love and the grandkids love. He's got cancer, so Monday's I got to go in and see a surgeon for him. So between Renee and my puppy, just keep us in your prayers.
Yeah. It's hard when the four-legged part of the family is hurting, isn't it? Okay. Let's have a little bit of music, maybe, and kneel for prayer. If you can't kneel, that's okay. God understands you're kneeling in your heart. Gracious God, we come to you today with hearts full of gratitude and a lot of things we're worried about. I thank you so much that we can give it all to you, knowing that you already know answers, you already know how to strengthen us and give us ideas on how to handle the things we're faced with. It's such a privilege
to be able to put all that stuff on you, dear God. I'm glad that your heart and your shoulders are big enough to handle it. And so we want to thank you first for birthdays and anniversaries and people getting better like Desiree's dad and our visitor Ken. We're so glad to see him today. And people who had safe trips and all the other things, dear God, our hearts are full when we stop to pay attention to what you've done for us. It's amazing. Thank you so much that Tracy listened to you and is able and knows how to help Dan and Vivian with their house, with their roof. I thank you for that so much. And I pray that he gets all the help he needs tomorrow to get this job done. We're thinking about people who have tests and aches and pains in various spots and going to have medical tests and like Betty facing cancer and like the dog who has cancer who is greatly beloved and also part of the family. We think of all of that. We think of houses that need to sell and the excitement of Cowboy Camp Meeting and how rain is needed in parts of the country and the guys at the prison and people who have huge job stresses like Vivian. We put all this on you, dear God, asking that you would give us strength to face what comes and asking that you would answer in your good time. We don't always know what that is, but we know that you know. And help us to continue having the faith that you will take care of what's wrong in the best time possible. I pray for Pastor Jim today as he brings us the word. Another psalm in summer. What a way to celebrate your goodness, and I thank you for those ideas and that those messages. So, dear God, please open our hearts and minds to what you have, the messages that you have planned for us today. May we draw closer to you than we've ever been before, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Kids, run back to the back, well, walk fast, and get your baskets and go around and see if people have money for you, because that money goes to help you, the kids who need it, go to camp, and us to pay for different things that we get to do for you and with you. And so, do I have any children going back to the back? That worries me a little. Maybe we need to have adults go back to the back. Oh, there we have. It's so handy that Hill and Patty have a lot of kids.
Over there. You got it. All right. Welcome to church, everybody. So I'm going to tell you a story about something that happened just yesterday. So yesterday, Miss Joy and I decided that we were going to go mountain biking. And how many of you guys have been skiing up at Bogus Basin or sledding up there? Well, you can mountain bike up there too, and you can take your bikes and go up the chairlift, and then you can go down some trails and stuff and have a good time mountain biking. So Joy and I decided to try that out. So we got up there, and we were rode the chairlift up, and we got on the trails. And you know what? We're not very good at mountain biking. So it was kind of challenging, and Miss Joy crashed. So you can see on her helmet, it's just a little dense. Can you see those right there? But can you imagine what would happen if she hadn't been wearing a helmet? It's hard to dent plastic. It's a lot easier to dent your head. So she was wearing a helmet, and that's very good. And I think we had little GoPro cameras on our bikes. I think we may have video of her crashing. I'll see if we can get it sometime. She'll love that. So I was thinking about that, and that reminded me of a part in the Bible that talks about the armor of God. Have you guys studied the armor of God in Sabbath school ever? So it's in Ephesians 6, 10 to 18, and it talks about the armor of God. And it starts out saying, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. And then later on down, it says, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So, you know, we don't do a whole lot of fighting now. There was a lot of fighting in the Bible, wasn't there? There's a lot of stories with people fighting and stuff, but we don't do a whole lot of fighting anymore. But there's still a good reason to use a helmet that we can think about there. So I'm going to paraphrase this, and we're going to say, take the bike helmet of salvation. And we're going to think, you know, the helmet protects us against things that can happen. It can also protect us against things that we do to ourselves. So we want to remember to take the helmet of salvation, which is God's promise to save us, and we want to wear that. We want to think about it. We want to use it in our life, just like we do when we ride our bikes, and especially when we're mountain biking. So you guys can go back to your seats. Thank you for coming today.
Okay, I'm really glad. You know, my mountain biking experience would probably not even leave the gate. Yes, I'm glad you did that, but I'm glad that you wore your helmet. Really glad. All right, it's time for our offering. Our offering emphasis today is church expense. And just a reminder that it's a really good thing when we replenish the emergency fund. So let's think about that because we have been using it a lot in the last few months. And that's a good thing because it means we can help one another. But it also means that we need to keep replenishing that fund. And anything that you give toward the church budget is a huge blessing. So please remember that. And deacons, please come forward. Gracious God, thank you for including us in your plan to help people. And I pray that we would remember to be generous with the needs of our church, because in the end, that is doing your work here. And so I ask that we would remember that, and that we would, and that you would bless every penny that's given. And bless the ones who can't give, dear God. That's a tough position to be in, too. But thank you so much again for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name. Thank you.
Good morning, CUNA. Good morning. This new sound system is just, it's everything I can do to not do. Good morning, CUNA. Let's get ready to rumble. Sorry, I didn't really do that just now, did I? Just testing it out, Jesse, just seeing what it'll do. So, wow.
I got nothing.
So thank you for being here. It's good to see each and every one of you this morning.
You know, coming to church kind of sends our...
And thank you for that, too. Gary, that was you. I know it was you. So coming to CUNA just kind of puts us in mind of what heaven's going to kind of be like. And we can kind of see the veil's kind of pulled back for just a second or two. And we can see the fellowship that's going to be involved in our heavenly place when we get there. So this morning we're going to sing about the sweet by and by. There's a land that is fairer than day.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet. Shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore. The spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessings of rest in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet.
So sweet to trust in Jesus.
It is so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise. And to know, thus saith the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to love him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust him. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that thou art with me, will be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Well, we know that the PowerPoint keeps going, but we're not going to keep going. Sorry. Thank you all for contributing this morning. It's so wonderful to hear all your voices. I can pick out some of you. It's really fun.
Yeah, please don't stop. Keep doing that. Just because we can hear you up here, keep doing that. Let's all stand as we sing this last song, A Quiet Place.
There is a quiet place far from the rapid pace where God can soothe
seated. I think we have someone to read our scripture this morning. There he is.
I will praise the Lord. I will thank the Lord with all my heart. In the meeting of his people, I will do great. The Lord does great things. Those people who love them think about them. What he does is glorious and splendid. His goodness continues forever. Psalms 111, 1 through 3.
I'm missing my wife and Hope. She holds all my stuff. I think I have that turned off. Tracy, you want to call me and find out? No. No. You know, where I came from, we had an individual at church, and Tracy's not like him, so I'm not comparing at all. But he used to like to see if you had your phone on when you got up to preach. And he'd get this big Cheshire Cat grin on his face when he got one, but somebody, you know. Hey, thank you, Webster. Thank you. Thank you, man. How'd you guys like that? It's good to have our young people reading. I just love it. I love it. I know that God has plans for everyone, but I especially like to see what he does in our young people's lives, because I just know that here in CUNA, somebody is being raised up to be a mouthpiece for God. Maybe it's Webster. I don't know, because God does that, doesn't he? Especially when we least expect it. I need a volunteer this morning. I have a volunteer. Anyone? Bob sort of raised his. He went like that. He went, come on up. Come on up. I didn't know if you were like, I'll do it if I have to. Come on up. All right, this is a simple experiment here. Let's see if we can bring this table out. I'll let you put that out here so people can see. All right. We're talking about the power and majesty of God. How many of you have a garden? All right. Vegetable or flower or otherwise. You know they work better when you water them, right? Yeah. Oh, yeah. But I have learned this truth here in Idaho, that when you do water it, it does grow. Right? Amen. So what we've got here, I have some garden beans here. Kentucky Wonder, that's what this one is. And I have a pot. What's in that pot?
Dirt.
Okay. Brown dirt. Well, yeah, there's different colors of dirt, I suppose. Yeah. And what do I have here?
Water.
All right, good. Good. He's a good volunteer. So anyway, Don, if I were to say we wanted to plant something in our garden, this is just for illustration's sake, we would get something to put it in, build either a garden box, or we'd have an area tilled up in the yard, or we put something in the pot. What we have here, as you said, is dirt. Mm-hmm. Now, you need dirt you need something with nutrients in it. I know there's hydroponics and different ways of growing plants nowadays, but we have the dirt. And you know, when I think of the dirt that we get, we look at it and say, I'll just go grab some dirt for it, right? Do you know when God made things, he made the dirt, right? Mm-hmm. So we look at it and we go, well, of course, you got to have dirt. You got to have something to grow the plant in. So we get dirt, and you know, I could say, go get me some dirt, but God got it out of where? Where did God get it? He made it, but where did he get it from? He made it out of nothing. He spoke and it came into being. So he has the dirt. He created that. And then we look and we say, well, we've got the water. You got to water the seed, right? Right? And I'm going to have you do that in a moment here. Who made the water? God. What did he make it out of? Okay, but again, out of nothing, right? He created it. You and I just go to the sink or whatever and we get the water, but God has it out of nothing. And then we get the seed, what we're actually going to grow. And I'm always amazed at this. Oops, we're probably only going to need one in here, right? You're going to get the honor. Now, so the seed is really cool because God in the seed, what is he? The seed came from whom? God. And again, he made it out of nothing. But in each seed, what is contained in each seed? Life. And the life, all the description of what that plant's going to be. It's there, already contained in the seed. The life itself is contained in there, and through germination, when you water it, you put it in the dirt, and it begins to germinate, God releases that life to come to be. That's incredible power. You and I, we take it, we go and we buy the bag at the Zamzos or wherever we get our seeds from, we buy our dirt, we buy, you know, we get our water, and we say, well, that's all there is to it. But brothers and sisters, it's pretty incredible when you think about this process right here and say, this all came out of nothing. God speaks and it comes to pass. So we're going to plant this here. Go ahead. You do it? Okay. You got to get it exactly that 1/8 inch or whatever they tell you, right? Right. Okay, go ahead. Now, and I put this underneath because I don't want to add, if the water, this has, well, that's probably a good. All right. Now it probably just, it's going to unbury it. You've got to put that down in there further. Here, can I wipe that on you?
No.
Okay, now what am I going to do?
That's what she got plans for.
Oh, that's what I got pants for, he says. Anyway, so if you, we'll let that sit here, and if you want, you could take that home later and see if that grows. If you don't want to, I'll take it home and see if it grows. All right. Thank you for coming up. So, oh, you got it. I'll point my finger all day, and that will be bad. And you know, within beans, for example, I was looking it up. There are thousands of varieties of beans. Most of them we probably have never had or heard of. That's pretty incredible. So God didn't just say, I'm going to make a bean. He said, I'm going to make beans A through Z and then some. And I'm going to just create them in my mind of what they're going to look like. I wonder oftentimes, did he draw any plans? God is amazing. He is powerful. He is majestic. He is a God that is worthy to be worshipped because of just his creative power alone. Thousands of varieties, even if we don't eat them all. And did you know that in all the plant kingdom, have you ever noticed the variety and the color and the shape and the size and the smell and of those things that we can eat, the taste? Isn't it pretty cool? Like even if we walk out our front door here at the church, we look to the left and we look to the right and we say, wow, there's some green in the trees. But did you know that there's variety in the color of green? Isn't that amazing? And when the lavender tree, is that what's right out front? Yeah, lilac, excuse me, not lavender. The lilac tree, when it's blooming, oh, that smells wonderful. Do you have a favorite flower? What's your favorite flower? Pansies and roses. Alyssum. Daisies, okay. Any others? Bird of paradise, all right. Okay, many different kinds that we all look at and we say, this is my favorite because, and we probably have our valid reasons. Maybe it's the smell. Maybe it brings back a fond memory. One that you don't like? Do you have a non-like? I don't like lilies because they for some reason, the smell of them, I like the look of them, but the smell of them, man, it almost overwhelms me and makes me like I'm not feeling well. Yeah. I've been told, and I don't know this, is anybody here a scientist? Maybe you can back it up if it's true or not true, but I have been told from a scientific standpoint that plants don't need to have color necessarily in order for the bees to pollinate them. Which, if that is true, what does that tell us about the power and the majesty of our God? It says that he created color for the purpose of just enjoyment, our enjoyment. If it didn't have to be there, and if that is a true statement, that really throws a wrench in the evolution idea that says only things that come through are come through because they're necessary for survival. If we could live in a black and white world without color in our plants, then it really throws that all out the window, doesn't it? And what that tells me is that our God likes variety. Our God likes to see us be happy around things. You know, he made plants smell good, most of them, right? He made edible plants taste good. We've learned a lot about plants, science has, and is still learning about plants from a medicinal standpoint. What does that tell us about our God? When he created, he didn't just create and say, yeah, I think I'm going to make this look nice, but it's not going to be of use to anybody. He had a plan in mind. And today, I want us to take a look at, spend some time in the Psalms, looking at just a few of the Psalms, and again, there's a bunch that will tell you that the psalmist recognized that our God is powerful and that our God is majestic and he is worthy to be praised based just on that. I liked Webster, what was your translation today? Is that an NIV? I'm not sure what it is, but I really like that. It says, because it indicates today, I guess, in the NIV that the psalmist is praising God for his power and his majesty, and he likes to hear it come from the lips of the people that are in the church. Isn't that good? You and I, of all people, ought to be people that look up and say, it's not about me, but we serve an awesome God. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you so much for today, the Sabbath day, the blessing of life itself, the promise that you have for each one of us, and you reveal that you're an awesome God every day to us, just from sunrise to sunset and everything in between as we look around. Help us to be more mindful of your handiwork, which reveals that you are majestic and powerful. We love you, Lord. Thank you for loving us. As we open your word today, Bless us, we pray, Holy Spirit, that we might understand what you have to say to us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so I'm just going to read through a few passages here. Again, these are not a summary of everything in the Psalms. You'll find, you can look some up, and you're going to find a whole bunch yourself. How many of you have been getting into the book of Psalms a little bit more these last few weeks? You can be honest. How many want to be? Okay, good. Today's a good day to start. We're going to start with Psalm 8. They call this a sandwich psalm. A sandwich psalm. Psalm 8. It's a short psalm. I know you're probably, some of you are thinking, how many is he going to read through today? Not too many. Psalm 8 is the one I'm going to read through the whole way. David writes, it's called a sandwich psalm. Does anybody know why it's called a sandwich psalm? Does anybody know that term? That's right. The same verse, the beginning and concluding verse are the same verse, or the same words. And that's why it's called a sandwich psalm. It's probably, that's a, probably a very non-theological, technical term, right? But I like it. And in between is all the meat. Tofu. By the way, I like tofu. And this, I'm going to give you a digression here really quick. Sherry makes a scrambled tofu. And when the kids were little, Hope used to say, I don't like tofu-ty. She didn't know what it was called, but she didn't like it. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise because of your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you've set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands and put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, all that swim in the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Wow. The psalmist is recognizing that God's pretty amazing, right? And then he gives us this privilege of being managers, stewards down here on this earth and taking care of all this beauty that he has created all around us. And next I'm going to take you to Psalm 19, just looking at one verse here. Psalm 19, verse 1, it says, the heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the work of his hands. Moving on, I guess verse 2 is, and 3 is good as well. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they display knowledge. There's no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Isn't that amazing? The psalmist looks and he says, I can look up in the sky and I can look around and I see that everything says, hello, I love you. Hello, I am powerful. Hello, I am God. Everywhere he looks, he says that it declares the glory of God. We get some, when it's not hazy, like this time of year with the forest fires, we get some pretty incredible skies at night, don't we? And you get out a little bit away from the city lights and you can see things that you've never knew were there. Thousands and thousands of stars. So far away that outside of Jesus' return and taking us there, we won't ever make it. I know NASA says otherwise. But we're talking light years, thousands of light years away. And yet we still see the light shining from those, we see the light shining from those stars, and we can say, wow, that's amazing. And the Hubble telescope, and again, I've shared a little bit, if you ever get a chance to watch Lou Giglio videos, and you see him describe and talk about these planets and how far out they are, and yet how big they are, and all the things that are being uncovered, that scientists are saying, wow, the universe is much bigger than we thought. The psalmist understood that, and he says, the heavens declare the glory of God. Psalm 68, verse 32 to 35. Let's go there. Psalm 68. I'm getting there ahead of you today, Bob. I'm ahead of you. I had that one marked. That's just being prepared. Okay. I like this one. Beginning at verse 32 of Psalm 68. Sing to God, O kingdoms of the earth. How many people does that include? Everyone, we should all be praising God. Sing to God, O kingdoms of the earth. Sing praise to the Lord, to him who rides the ancient skies above, who thunders with mighty voice. Proclaim the power of God, whose majesty is over Israel, whose power is in the skies. You are awesome, O God, in your sanctuary. The God of Israel gives power and strength to his people. Praise be to God. The psalmist is saying, and he, before this, he's gone through many things that God has done. We've looked at some of those psalms in the past couple weeks, the things that God has done, and he's saying, God, you are amazing. We should be singing about it regularly. We should be telling about it, proclaiming it, that you are the God who has power and majesty. All of creation declares that God is an awesome, powerful God. When I think of creation, of this world that we live in, this atmosphere that we live in, do you know it's pretty incredible? I looked it up to see what the Earth's atmosphere is made of, and it says, and again, I know we probably have some scientists here and that are know a lot more about this stuff than I do, but it's composed of just the right amount of argon, nitrogen, and oxygen. Some trace minerals in there as well, but those three are the main three. And from what I understand, here it says trace amounts of other elements that include carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, hydrogen, helium, nitrous oxide, and ozone. The nitrous oxide, I suppose, makes us go fast, right? Isn't that what that's for in cars? Yeah. But what I understand is it's an amazing thing, and it baffles scientists because they say it's exactly where it needs to be. If we had too much or too little of any of those components, none of us would be here today. What does that tell you? God is in charge and he knows. And he says, I'm going to create this being that's going to inhabit this earth, and I'm going to create creatures that are going to inhabit this earth, animal kingdom and the insect world and everything else. I'm going to create that, and it's going to need the perfect ideal conditions to live in. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to put this much of oxygen in, this much of argon in, this much of nitrogen, and a few of these others to keep it balanced. Pretty incredible. God spoke. As I look at the Genesis creation account, it says that God spoke everything into existence. And he looked and he said, it's very good. He designed it just as it needed to be, with perfect balance, to keep it working forever, as long as sin didn't enter. Right? But isn't God amazing that even after sin enters, we can still look around, and as much as we can see where this world has been in upheaval, and as much as we can see tragedy, and as much as we can see the effects of sin, we can still look around and say, God is awesome, because we still see the beauty. Head up to McCall. Head over to down to the Grand Canyon, or over to Yellowstone. And any place in between. And you see it's still, the creation is still speaking, God, you're amazing. Think about it for just a moment. And then if you've got some responses, I'll let you share. When you, the psalmist looked up to the heavens and said, the heavens declare your handiwork. What is it that draws your attention to say, God, you're awesome? When you see it, what is it that makes you thank God for his power and for his majesty? What things go through your mind? Yes. A newborn baby. That's right. And for any of you moms, when you're carrying that baby, I just can't, I never could figure it out with Sherry. You know, of course, I get to feel the baby kick and all of that stuff. But you're carrying life that's growing inside you that then comes out alive. It's amazing. Amazing. Okay, so newborn babies. Any other thoughts? What draws your attention to be able to be like the psalmist? Yes. Sunsets. Oh, and we get some fantastic ones over here. I was told before I moved here, you're going to see some fantastic sunsets. We get glorious sunsets here. Yes. And you know what I really like is when they not only have the red and the orange in it, but a little bit of that purple color, when there's a little bit of clouds. Oh, that's fantastic. Yes. What else causes you to declare God is awesome? Oceans. You were going to say ocean?
No, I was going to say the Cascade
Mountain. Okay. Okay. And just about any mountain range, and go back to the ocean. What is it about the ocean that you... Amen. And you know what? Not all, and all birds are different too, right? Yeah, yeah. You know, when I think of just the bird, I was not a bird person growing up, and then when we moved, I met Sherry, and we moved out in the country, and you get to see a lot more birds than you do in the city, and she got me a bird book, and it's like, now again, I'm still not very good at it, but I like watching them, because you really quickly learn, you learn pecking orders, you learn who is the top bird in the neighborhood type of a thing, you know? You learn which ones have a nice song, and then you learn that there's some like the jaybirds that and crows that really just sound like they should never sing, right? Right? But that'll be. But you know what? They're making a joyful noise too, and I like. I'm with you. I like the hummingbirds because I like how they can fly forward and stop and fly backwards. That's just, yeah. And there was I saw a hand up over here. Did I? Yes. Go ahead, Betty. Okay. Yes, did anybody see that elephant video recently that just came out this week, the one with the baby elephant that was stuck in a canal? For those of you that didn't see it, it was pretty incredible. This little baby elephant is stuck upside down in the canal, and the lions are approaching, and the mom elephant's trying to get the attention of the rest of the herd, and she does, and they come running over, and one of them gets the trunk around. They have strong trunks. Wraps the trunk around the little baby elephant, it keeps pulling and pulling, and then the elephant comes out of the canal and is safe. Yes, how they care. Yes, Bob. Yes, yes. And every place has its beauty.
Our Idaho is a beautiful place to live.
That wasn't me. Look, something just fell right there. Manna. It's time for a church work bee, I think. Okay. Yes, you're right. And we have to have eyes that pay attention to say, this is God's handiwork. Right? Yes. Go ahead, Nancy. Music. Okay. Isn't it incredible? The gift, yeah, what God has done through music, giving us abilities. And I am so grateful Amanda's back. You know, I was thinking about when Amanda or any of our pianists, when they're up playing, okay, It's enough to be the singing part of it and leading in singing and praise team, but to go to someone like Amanda and say, Amanda, here's our songs, can you play them? And she just gets in there and just plays, right? That's a gift. It's a beautiful sound too. Music is beautiful, yes. Okay. Amen. When you see, has anybody never been, we have any that's not been to Grand Canyon yet? Maybe a few of you. And it's okay if you haven't, because I didn't get there until just a few years ago. But when you see it, it's nothing like the pictures you see, right? And you just see it, doesn't matter where you're at in the Grand Canyon, you just stand there and you just go, mouth just drops open, doesn't it? Yeah, beautiful. And that is beauty out of destruction. Which is amazing.
You know what?
Yes. Okay. Okay. Yes, that's right. That's right. And we can we should be not only in addition to thanking that animal or thinking about how that much that animal matters, looking up to heaven and saying, God, you're amazing. Norlin. That's all we know. Yes, yes, amazing, amazing stuff. Folks, there is a lot that we ought to be looking up and looking around and saying, God, you are amazing. And the Psalms is there to help us to be directed toward that. Another Psalm, Psalm 145, I'm going to look at verses 1 through 7, Psalm 145. David says here, I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. How long is he planning on praising God? Forever and ever. He's repeated it already. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. We are supposed to be, as believers, we should be telling our children, anybody who will listen, look, God loves you and he is amazing. And it shouldn't be hard to be able to talk about things like that. I know some people are not receptive, but I believe when David is talking, passing it on to the next generation, it's not only so they won't forget, but a lot of times that younger generation, when their kids are going to listen. How many of you, we found that as people get older, they just go, yeah, whatever. But I want to tell you, it's terrible. But the reality is that's the way some people get. They get their set ways and they say, I'm not going to listen to anything anymore. Tell it to the children. One generation will commend your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. They will speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. They will tell the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They will celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing to your righteousness. The psalmist is here saying, we should do it collaboratively, together, as a group, and we should do it individually. We should be telling people about what God has done for us, who he is to us. Throughout the Bible, from cover to cover, we find evidences of God's power and his majesty. From the creation story to the parting of the Red Sea, from the talking donkey to a floating axe head, to the sun standing still, to defeating armies without a battle, God is powerful. But perhaps no stories of power are greater than those we find in the New Testament in the life of Jesus Christ. Because in him we see God incarnate, in the flesh, coming here to say, this is what I am like. This is how much I love you. But we see it over and over. Jesus healing the sick. Jesus forgiving people who thought their life was over, that their life was hopeless. Jesus resurrecting people that are dead, like Lazarus. But even more important, the raising of himself after he was crucified. And those who thought that they had silenced him forever, oops, right? Jesus demonstrated that he has power even over death itself. In Jesus, we see lives changed, the lost found, sinners redeemed, and guess what? It's still happening today. Next Sabbath after church, this is a wonderful story. This wasn't planned, but I'm privileged to be a part of it. A family that was at Meadow Glade, their son is fourth grade or so now, I think fourth or fifth, been studying to be baptized. They had moved to Walla Walla. And if you have been following news at all, Walla Walla, one of the pastors over there, his name is Patty McCoy. And he just got called to another area back in Ohio, Kettering, Ohio. And so she contacted me and she said, Jameson's baptism, it's all scheduled still for the 12th. Would you be able to do it? And I said, well, if you let me come over in after church and come up in the evening. And she said, that would be fine. We have another young man, 10 years old or so, who has given his heart to the Lord and said, I want to follow Jesus. And it's because he's learned that God is gracious, that God is powerful, that God is amazing, and he's putting his trust in him. Today, I want you to know, folks, in the Psalms, we find that God is worthy of our worship because his power and his majesty are unrivaled, unparalleled. There are all kinds of people worshiping all kinds of things, but if it's not God, it's not God. God is worthy to be exalted because he made everything out of nothing, full of variety and complexity, and yet simple enough that you and I can enjoy it. I don't understand how a bean seed is going to be produce a bunch of beans, but I do get to enjoy them when they grow, right? And you can apply that to just about anything. God is worthy to be praised because he sustains life. Every breath we take, every heartbeat we have is a reminder that our God is in charge. Our God is worthy of worship because his power is pure, and he uses it as a noble and majestic king. He doesn't wield it around and say, look at me, I'm going to destroy this and that. Instead, he looks for ways that he can bring life. He does it from the goodness of his heart because he is a God that the Bible says is love. One more passage before we conclude, and it's found in the New Testament in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 17. Some of you know where I'm going with this. Paul was in Athens, and he saw people philosophizing. Is that a word? You know what? You can make up words once in a while, okay? You may not remember me for a lot of things years down the road if I ever, for whatever reason, not here, but you'll know, you'll say, yeah, that was the guy that made up words, philosophizing. Okay. Acts chapter 17, verse 24, go verse 24 down to 28. Paul is there, he's listening to them give their ideas about if there's God and what is God and so forth. And he sees a perfect opportunity to give his two cents. He says, the God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and doesn't live in temples built by hands. Isn't that good news? And he isn't served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. From one man he made every nation of men that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he isn't far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. When Paul shared this, he was doing what only he could do, and that is declare God's goodness. He wanted to make sure that if they're going to talk about the God that he knows, that they got the right picture. And he said, if you're going to give your views on this kind of thing, you ought to know who he is. He made the earth. He made everything in it. He doesn't need anything from you. He's there to be found by you. He wants to be found by you. Seek him out, and he'll be there. And in addition, don't forget, everything you're about, he did it. Everything you have is because of him. When the Godhead, the Father, Son, and Spirit created, they did it because they loved. They wanted us to know that we can depend on them for everything. God's power and majesty reinforce this truth with every breath we take, and every moment in creation that takes our breath away. In the Psalms, we find that not only is God trustworthy and loving, he backs that up with the evidence of his power and his majesty. And you and I are called to seek out God and come to him who has come to us through Jesus the Son, and who daily still comes to us through the Holy Spirit. And in his majesty, Jesus calls you and I to come out of darkness into light, and to be his friends, not only that, but part of his family. By his power and his majesty, you and I have been redeemed. There is no other name under heaven by which we might be saved except that of Jesus Christ. And all that God does that demonstrates his power and his authority and his majesty is to help us to look and say, I can trust you. I can count on you. And today, brothers and sisters, that's why there is none like our God. And I hope that throughout the Sabbath and throughout the week ahead, maybe you'll spend some time in the Psalms and you'll say, let me take a look and see what I can find about how awesome God is. Let me see what I can find about how amazing and how powerful and majestic he is. And then don't forget to take some time to look around, as you've mentioned, in nature and see what he's done. And I think your head will be spinning because it's mind-boggling, the God that we serve. He's incredible, and yet he has said, I don't expect you to understand me, but I understand you, and I want you to be with me forever. Trust me. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I thank you so much for being with us this morning, for blessing us with your presence, for helping us to understand you better.
for loving us no matter what. Each one of us. The world might have said to us, any one of us, you're not worth it, but you never gave up, and you don't give up. Each one of us can look at our shortcomings and say, maybe I would say I'm not worth it. But again, you have loved us with an everlasting love, and you said, but I created you, therefore you are worth it. Today, may we understand you better. May we recognize and put it in the core of our being that you are a powerful God, strong enough to do whatever it is you need to do, in particular, in the redemption of mankind. You demonstrated that by sending us Jesus Christ, your Son, who has loved us and shown us what you are like and how much you love us, that we might be your children. Thank you for all of your promises, and thank you for all the ways that you demonstrate to us day by day that you are worthy to be praised. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we're going to have a closing song before we conclude our service today.
Majesty indeed. Let's stand as we sing our closing song today.
Majesty, worship His majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, power, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, flow from His throne unto His own, His anthem reigns. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify and glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship His majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Majesty, worship His majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, power, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, flow from His throne unto His own, His anthem reigns. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship His majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
I got it. Okay, good. Listen, we have reason to smile.
Amen.
If you just stop and think about it, God could have done a whole bunch of things, but what He did was He said, I love you. And He created this world, and He created you and I that we might fellowship together and fellowship with Him. And one day it's going to be for eternity. Amen?
Amen.
Think about that. As you go forth this Sabbath day, I just pray that you'll just trust in and know that your God is dependable and He loves you beyond what you can imagine. That's why He's created this world and shows you the power that He does show you. Amen. God bless each and everyone. Have a great Sabbath.